Welcome to the Red Carpet Movie Review.
Today we're going to review The Last Jedi.
Ladies and gentlemen, live from Hollywood, California, welcome to the Red Carpet Review, starring the showstopper, Shawn Valentino, also starring Rich Twilling.
Today, we review Star Wars, The Last Jedi.
Live from the red carpet.
Hey everybody, this is Shawn Valentino, your host on the Red Carpet Movie Review. And today we're going to review Star Wars, The Last Jedi. Now, Star Wars, The Last Jedi is directed by Rian Johnson and it stars Mark Hamill returning to his iconic role as Luke Skywalker. And of course, we also have Carrie Fisher here returning as Princess Leia, as well as Daisy Ridley, John Boyega, and an ensemble cast of great actors. And as all of you know, this is the latest in the Star Wars saga, officially Episode 8. And I'm sure most of you have seen this film already, but I'll still keep it spoiler-free. And I want to start off by saying that I thought this was the weakest of the new three Star Wars movies. I thought that Rogue One was a very strong film. It was an amazing standalone entry into the Star Wars franchise. And I thought The Force Awakens was just an excellent film that had the perfect mix of nostalgia while introducing us to new characters that we really care about. So I was really excited to see the continuing journey of Rey and Finn and how they're going to interact with the classic characters like Princess Leia and of course the legendary Luke Skywalker. And I thought the best part of this movie was Mark Hamill reprising his role as Luke Skywalker. I thought he was just absolutely excellent here. He hasn't played this character in decades, but he brings it back to life in epic fashion. And every time Luke was on screen, I think the entire audience was in a sense of awe because this is one of the most famous characters and most legendary characters in film history. And not only that, he's a huge part of most of our childhoods. He's an integral part of an entire generation of kids that grew up watching these Star Wars movies. And I thought he did a great job here. He had that perfect mix of intelligence, humor, as well as gravitas. And I think that when you see him on screen, it kind of reminds me of seeing Obi-Wan Kenobi on screen in the original Star Wars movies. And I think Hamill as Luke is as good as he's ever been, and possibly better than he even was in the original trilogy. And I think he really captures the essence of what made this character so great, and the fact that he was very heroic. He's a classic Joseph Campbell hero's journey lead character, but at the same time there was always something a little bit whiny and weaselly about Luke as well in the original trilogy, and I think he brings some of that back too. So I thought Hamill was absolutely fantastic here, and I think he's the highlight of this movie. And you also get to see Luke interact with a lot of these other classic characters that you haven't seen him interact with in decades, and there's some fun surprises here that I won't spoil, but whenever these scenes took place, I was almost in tears because, again, it brought back so many moments from my own childhood, and it was just a wave of nostalgia going through the audience, and I thought they did an excellent job of bringing those moments to life. And of course, Carrie Fisher passed away last year, and I thought she was excellent again as Princess Leia. She brought this real elegance and depth to the role, and obviously there was a sense of pathos when she was on screen because we know she's passed away in real life, and we didn't know how the filmmakers were going to handle this. And obviously this is the last performance that Carrie Fisher ever filmed. And I think she's just wonderful here in her most famous character. And I was just really so happy to see Princess Leia portrayed so beautifully once again. But the heart of this film revolves around the two new characters of Kylo Ren and Rey. And I thought they did a wonderful job of portraying these parallel journeys. You have Rey on the light side of the Force, you have Kylo Ren on the dark side. But the filmmakers did a good job of portraying this dichotomy and how each side is teased to turn to the other. And I thought the film did an excellent job of portraying this thin line between good and evil and showing each character with their internal struggles, trying to figure out what their place in the world is. And I thought that Daisy Ridley and Adam Driver did a great job of portraying these internal struggles. And I thought one of the highlights of The Force Awakens were the interactions between Rey and Han Solo, who was kind of this mentor-like father figure to her. And now you have another father figure type character in Luke. And I really enjoyed the interactions that those two had on screen. I thought they had some good chemistry. Not quite as good as she had with Harrison Ford in The Force Awakens, but I thought they had some great scenes together. And it really portrayed some magic moments on film. And I thought another one of the highlights of this movie was the fabulous use of practical settings. One of the worst things about those prequels was they felt like video games. There's so much CGI there that I got completely disconnected from the entire film-going experience. I thought there were too many actors acting against green screen, and that's one of the reasons why the performances came out is so unnatural. But here you have a mix of CGI and some great location settings. I thought that Croatia and Ireland were just showcased beautifully in this movie. Those are places I've traveled to in the past. And this movie is going to make you want to go to places like the Ring of Kerry in Ireland and Dubrovnik in Croatia. And even though I didn't like this movie as much as Rogue One or The Force Awakens, I thought they did an excellent job of really recapturing that Star Wars feel, that certain sense of magic that's just really difficult to explain, but you just know it's there when you're watching the movie. That's something that the prequels really lacked. You just had this sense of goofiness, and they just didn't feel like Star Wars movies. I thought Revenge of the Sith captured a little bit of that, but I thought most of this movie had that epic Star Wars feel to it. And there are just some very awe-inspiring moments here that are going to go down in time as some of the great moments in film history. And it even had a callback to my favorite moment in the history of movies, the binary sunset scene in the original Star Wars. Look for it, and I think you're going to be in awe too. And although I really did enjoy this movie, I thought that it was heavily flawed. And I think one of the main issues I had with this film was it felt really disjointed. I thought it was overstuffed with too many characters. There are too many unnecessary subplots that just weren't very interesting. I thought the entire journey of Finn in this movie was completely a waste. I didn't really care about any of the scenes he was in. And I thought you could take off his entire arc in this film. It might have been a better movie because it would have been more focused on the parallel journeys of Rey and Kylo Ren. And I really thought that Finn was one of the strong points of the first film. I thought he was amazing in that movie, but in this movie, Boyega's acting is fine, but I thought the character was just really horribly written. And I thought that the adventure and the mission that they sent him on was really lame and boring, and I found myself disengaged every time he was on screen in this movie. And I also thought that all the new characters were pretty much worthless. In the original trilogy in Empire Strikes Back, we were introduced to Lando, we were introduced to Yoda, some of the most famous characters in Star Wars history. But what do we get here? I thought the character of Rose was just completely useless. I didn't like her at all. I thought she was totally miscast. She seemed to come off the set of some 80s sitcom. She just didn't have the feel of a Star Wars character. I thought she had a bad sense of humor. Her look wasn't right for a Star Wars movie, and I thought she felt completely out of place here. And even worse was the character of Admiral Holdo, played by Laura Dern. And I thought Laura Dern just looked like she stepped off the set of Bad Moms or something. She looked completely out of place in this movie. Her look was very awkward, and every time she was speaking, it looked like she was giving a very bad audition. And I thought this role really requires someone with a sense of elegance and grace. And imagine how good this role would have been if you had Nicole Kidman or Michelle Pfeiffer, someone that really has a lot of gravitas and a very elegant, graceful presence. And I don't think Laura Dern really has that, and I thought she was horribly miscast in this movie, and her character was really poorly written as well, so maybe it was just a character that just shouldn't have been in the movie at all. And tied to that, I thought this movie was just struggling way too much to try to be politically correct, and it failed miserably at it. Just throughout the movie, it just looked like the filmmakers were trying to cater to every demographic. And that's fine if you can do it properly, but here it just comes across as patronizing and contrived. Just give me a good movie. Don't try to pander to the audience. A lot of people are complaining about this, but I think it's rightfully so, because the attempt at being politically correct really harms this movie a lot. And it brings us a bunch of weak characters that I don't think anybody really cares about. And on top of that, one of the main things that makes Star Wars movies so great are the great villains. And obviously you have Darth Vader, who might be the greatest villain in movie history. You have Emperor Palpatine, who is also excellent. But this movie focuses more on Supreme Leader Snoke, who we saw in the first film, who we weren't really given a suitable explanation for who he is. He just looks like a goofy CGI mess straight out of a Harry Potter movie or a Lord of the Rings movie. I don't think he really has the feel of a Star Wars character. And I thought he was okay here, but I don't think he's one of the stronger villains in Star Wars history. And I thought that really weakens the movie because we don't really know a lot about his backstory or what his motivation is. You also have General Hux, played by Domino Gleeson, an actor I really like, and I thought he was very good in the first movie. It's one of the classic Star Wars tropes, having these Nazi-like characters. But I don't know about you guys, I just thought he was just way too goofy here and camping it up. There's a certain campiness that goes with playing a Star Wars villain, especially the type that he's playing, but I just found him having this weird smirk on his face the entire time, as if he was just too self-aware that he was just hamming it up. I think those type of performances have their place. When it's that obvious that you have that smirk on your face the entire time, it really took me out of the moment whenever he was on screen. And I thought Oscar Isaac was very good here as Poe Dameron. He's very likable. He's got a very heroic presence about him. I don't think he's been given any good material to work with in the last two movies. And sadly, even though he's solid in his role, he comes across as a B-grade Han Solo, minus the charisma and the swagger. But despite my problems with this movie, I'm still going to recommend it. Obviously, most of you have already seen it already. I thought overall the good definitely outweighed the bad. There were some awe-inspiring moments here, some epic character interactions, and the return of one of the greatest heroes in the history of movies in Luke Skywalker, in grand fashion because he gave an excellent performance here. And although I did think they lost their focus too many times in this movie, having too many side characters and unnecessary subplots, I thought there was enough there in the journeys of Rey and Kylo Ren to make this a highly enjoyable film to watch. I want to conclude by saying that Daisy Ridley is just absolutely fantastic as Rey. Not only is she beautiful, she has that perfect sense of grace and elegance and power without being too overly contrived or manipulative to the audience. Just an excellent character, and what a perfect casting choice. And this is going to sound like a little bit of a strange compliment, but the casting of her as Rey is every bit as strong as it was weak in the casting of Hayden Christensen as Anakin Skywalker. She's absolutely fabulous here, and I'm really looking forward to seeing her journey continue. And although this is called The Last Jedi, I'm really looking forward to Rey's hero's journey towards becoming the next Jedi. And we here at the Red Carpet Review like to rate our movies on a 5-star scale, and I'm going to give The Last Jedi 3.5 stars on a 5-star scale. Thank you so much for watching this Red Carpet Review of The Last Jedi, and we have one of our Star Wars experts here. Now, what'd you think about this red carpet review?
Exactly.
Thank you for that expert opinion. And thank you so much for watching. Be sure to click that like button and press subscribe. And we'll see you next week on the red carpet.
Thank you for watching the Red Carpet Review. Proceed to click that like button and press subscribe for weekly movie reviews past and present. We'll see you soon on the red carpet.